We stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Good evening, everyone. This is Sam. Roll call, please.
Ryan?
Here.
Sanfilippo?
Here.
McCarty?
Here.
Carstensen is absent. Madigan is absent. Turner?
Here.
Henning?
Here.
Yeah.
Okay.
More just
okay. Okay. Could we have a vote for approval of Mr. Ryan being online this evening?
I'll make the motion.
I'll second.
Okay. Brian?
Yes.
Sanfilippo?
Yes.
McCarty?
Yes.
Turner?
Yes.
Penny?
Yes. Okay. Now we have approval of the minutes for the February 2024 meeting.
So I'll make a second.
Okay. Brian?
Yes.
Sanfilippo?
Yes.
Party?
Yes.
Turner?
Yes.
Penny?
Yeah. Yes. Staff updates.
Madam Chairperson, there's no updates.
Okay, thank you. Then we go to old business, RPIL Solar 4, LLC 2315 variance special use site plan remanded back to the Village Board. We talked to the petitioner. We all want a good hearing tonight, but one that doesn't rehash old facts that we have already heard. And we'll turn it over to the parliamentarian for the form of a motion.
Thank you. And I did speak to counsel for the petitioner, who is very agreeable to this. The one thought would be just to make sure, as the chair artfully said, that we do not rehash everything, that we make a motion to limit debate to items with regards to the findings of fact, new facts as presented, and any questions that the members of the Planning and Zoning Commission have. I can explain what that motion would entail if I need to any further. Mr. Ryan?
Not at this time.
Okay. Madam Chair, if that works, there would just be a motion to limit the debate as previously mentioned. That's fine.
So moved.
Second.
Ryan?
Yes.
Sanfilippo?
Yes.
McCarty?
Yes.
Turner?
Yes.
Penny?
Yes. Okay. So we will move on. Okay. At this point, if you would please identify yourself. And we need you, yes. And when anyone who is going to give testimony, if you would please stand and be sworn in. You can do.
Anyone providing testimony before this body today, please raise your right hand. You swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. You are sworn. Thank you.
Madam Chair, do we want to do public comment?
Yes, we could do, if you...
Just up to you. I just didn't know. There was two people up here that I want to let you know.
Yeah, that's fine. That would be fine. Public comments. Do we have public comments? Have to be sworn. Mm-hmm. Okay. Do you want to swear? And please state your name, your address, and then be sworn in.
Okay. My name is Nikki Georgia. I live at 660 Asbury Court here in Antioch.
Can you please raise your right hand?
Yes.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do. Members of the board, thank you for the opportunity to share my input. I consider Antioch to be my adult hometown. I moved here shortly after college in 1998, got married, bought a house, raised a family, and now I teach in Antioch. I love the charming downtown, the family atmosphere, and the beautiful parks in the area. Antioch is home. A lot has changed in Antioch since I moved here in 1998. The most notable and consequential things are the addition of hundreds of homes and many businesses east of town on 173. A lot of forethought went into preparing for that expansion, including infrastructure such as stormwater runoff, extending utilities, remodeling and restructuring the schools, and many other details that accompany growth. Nevertheless, all of these new homes and businesses mean Antioch is consuming significantly more energy than it did 20 years ago. When I moved to the area, I started to learn more about our region. One thing I noticed is that we are fortunate. Zion has a nuclear power plant, and Grays Lake is home to the county's landfill. While I am grateful that Antioch does not have either of those things, I do think it is time for Antioch to seize the opportunity to contribute to the infrastructure of the area. The proposed solar project gives us the perfect opportunity to generate enough green energy to power hundreds of homes, all of this with no threat to the environment and no threat to the safety and health of Antioch's residents. Doubtless, there are those who will say, not in my backyard. Were this a coal-fired power plant that would spew harmful pollutants into the air we breathe and mar the view, I would join my voice with those saying NIMBY. This is not that time. This is the time to step up and seize the opportunity to contribute to the clean energy infrastructure in our area. I urge you to please approve this permit. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Samuel Beard, B-E-A-R-D. My address is 70 East Lake Street, Chicago, Illinois, 60601, number 1500.
Raise your right hand, please. You swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
I do. Thank you. Good evening, Antioch Village Planning and Zoning Commission. My name is Sam Beard, and I'm a conservation organizer for Sierra Club, Illinois. I'm speaking on behalf of over 160 Sierra Club members and supporters who reside within the Village of Antioch. These are folks who vote in very high numbers and volunteer locally and are generally very active members of their local communities here. We are at a pivotal moment in the human story where each decision that we make and each decision our institutions make and our appointed and elected officials make have profound consequences for the years to come. And they set a precedent for what the rest of our lives are gonna look like. They also have real tangible consequences immediately and for future generations. We know this. The decision before you today could ultimately be chalked up on aesthetic considerations or what I might say are baseless concerns about pollution to fragile wetland ecosystems, which are very important to me. The Woods and Wetlands group is this local Sierra Club group. I've worked preserving local wetlands throughout Lake County for the last 6.5 years, and I grew up not too far from here, and I've lived in Illinois my whole life. So this region's very important to me. I considered moving out to the chain of lakes a couple months ago, and it didn't pan out, but that's okay. So this place is very close to me. I urge you to fold in other criteria as well into your decision-making factors tonight and in general, and these are sort of the realm of responsible stewardship, ethics, and with generally a strategic disposition towards the future with the Antioch residents in mind. First, I guess I ask that you listen to your senses. You know, we, and trust your gut on these decisions that you make. Just about a week ago, maybe 2 weeks ago, it was 73 degrees here in Antioch in February. 73 degrees in February. And we all know why. The world's changing. The world's getting hotter. Weather's getting unpredictable and strange. And it's going to continue to happen increasingly. And the decisions that we make now, no matter how small they might be, will materially contribute to making sure that our world is more livable for our kids and for their kids. I guess finally, as we face an uncertain future, I ask that the decisions you make best equip the Village of Antioch to weather it. the more infrastructure that we make that will produce locally and has the capacity to produce energy locally within our bounds will just provide a baseline level of stability for an inherently unstable future that we all know is coming. The more homes in the village of Antioch that local energy infrastructure can provide energy to, the less the village of Antioch and its residents will have to rely on multinational petroleum, coal, and fracked gas conglomerates for their energy needs, thereby making a sort of baseline level of self-determination for the people of the city. The decision to advance this renewable properties development is a decision that should be made in accordance with your gut, with what your senses are telling you, and with what is best for your kids, your neighbors, and the village of Antioch. Thank you for your time and for what you do. Please approve the permits for this project. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Garrigan.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Madam Chairperson. Just housekeeping matters. You have a revised staff report that was submitted. One of the clarifications for housekeeping, I have walked through the findings of facts several times. So if you excuse me, I don't think I would cover the findings of facts. I think staff did summarize in our staff report our perspective. Deserves a slightly revised staff report, but most importantly, from a housekeeper's perspective, there is within this proposed revised staff report, there is a series of proposed recommendations. If in fact the Planning Commission does make a determination that based on the additional testimony or information that will be provided tonight, that there is in fact support for the applicant's requested special use or variance and site plan, there is a series of proposed recommendations with highlight stipulations in support of this proposed project. In addition, if in fact the Planning Commission makes a determination that they want to basically reiterate or concur with their previous recommendation of denial, there is a set of findings of fact that are separate from my staff report. I think you can look at staff report and summarize by reviewing this what staff's position is as it relates to this proposed entitlement request. But there are two sets of proposed findings of facts. So I did not want to confuse the Planning Commission about that. Again, there's a separate findings of fact which are highlighted in staff's report in support of the proposed project, but there's also a separate set of findings of fact. So with that, I'll conclude my staff report. Be more than happy to answer any questions that you have.
Mr. Ryan, do you have any questions on it?
Not at this time.
Ms. Sanfilippo?
No.
Mr. McCarty? At this time, do you have anything?
Nope.
Mr. Turner?
Not at this time.
Okay, and we can proceed.
Madam Chair, members of the board, thank you for the opportunity to present additional evidence pertaining to our Deep Lake Road solar project. My name is Brian Madigan. I'm a director of permitting at Renewable Properties. And we wanted to take this opportunity to reconnect and expand on three of the primary concerns that we heard through the course of the last PZB meeting. Based on the PZB's deliberation, it sounded like the board felt that the project was not consistent with the community or visual character of the estate district, that the project would potentially have adverse effects on ecological areas, most importantly, Red Wing Slough, and that the project could adversely affect home values. And so we wanted to take this opportunity to go back to those three topics and elaborate. So we've brought in the leading expert on avian solar related issues. His name is Carl Kostchek. He's presenting via Zoom tonight, and he will be able to expound and address the concerns about avian welfare in the project's proximity to Red Wing Slough. We also have Drew Lines from Cohn Resnick, who's going to present some additional information on property values. And from the renewable properties perspective, we've been actively trying to understand what the pulse of the community actually is. We've conducted a survey, and we've had some representatives out in the field collecting signatures and trying to understand what the support or opposition actually looks like. This is all to say, we took what you had to say in your conversation and questions at the last meeting to heart. And, you know, we want to propose and build a project that conforms with the community character and respects the unique environmental conditions of the site that we're working with. So I was going to start by addressing the concerns around community character. I wanted to go back to, first of all, the landscaping proposal along North Avenue. To be clear, the landscaping that we've proposed is pretty robust. It's 30 foot wide. It's been designed by a professional landscape architect to specifically screen views from the road and from the neighbors across the street. I know that was a primary concern from folks. So, you know, how is it going to change the character of their views? People don't want to look at a solar project. I understand that. So the screening consists of native indigenous evergreen trees.
Excuse me, we've already been through all that, so I don't think we need to go through the landscaping again.
Okay, no problem. In head, there was, based on the village board meeting, some questions about agrivoltaics and how the project might be, you know, reseeded at the time of completion of construction. And so we have proposed a pollinator seed mix. It's worth noting, in a conversation with the Illinois Department of Natural Resources, I had following the last planning and zoning board meeting, you know, I specifically asked their perspective on, you know, the comparison in terms of uses, solar versus agriculture, and their opinion over the phone, albeit, was that solar would represent a beneficial use in the sense that it would reduce stormwater runoff, it would improve habitat quality, and provide an opportunity for the soil to generate. The question at the village board meeting that was asked was specifically related to agrivoltaics, and that in the industry has a specific connotation where sheep are used for vegetation management. And that allows the project to retain an agricultural production value, actively producing value in terms of monetary value for the byproducts of you know, the sheep and wool, meat, et cetera. So, that is not part of our application at this time, but if that is something that the board would like to see, we're certainly open to that as a condition of approval, recognizing that, you know, this is historically been used as an agricultural use.
I have one question. I'm sorry. You used the word agrivoltaics, and I'm just a country lawyer. So what does that mean? Like, what is just for the board, so the board knows, and maybe the board knows, and I'm just the only one who doesn't know, but what does that word mean, agrivoltaics?
So it's agrivoltaic.
See, I didn't even know how to say it, so that's how far off I am, but yeah, agrivoltaics. Got it, okay.
Sure, so the concept there, we're implementing it on one of our projects in New York State, rather than mechanical mowing throughout the summer and the growing season, sheep are brought in by
sheep
farmer. Yes.
Okay.
So the sheep graze the site. They're pretty nimble. They can slide under the rows of panels, and they don't chew on the wires like goats would or something, you know, another species. That provides a benefit to a local farmer who's raising sheep. They have a place to actually graze their herd. The forage here, the pollinator seed mix, provides excellent nutritional value because it's rich in forbs and grasses that are good for the sheep's health.
Yeah, I just didn't know. I didn't know that the sheep were lawn mowers, and that's what agrovoltaics meant. Okay.
You should get with me.
Yeah.
Okay. Next slide. So the other topic I wanted to discuss was the mention from the board and from Mr. Garrigan's staff report of community character and the compatibility of the project with the estate district. And so, we were looking through the comprehensive plan. Next slide. Looking at our visual simulations and how the project, looks from North Avenue at year five here. You can't see the interior of the site. You can't see the panels or anything. But perhaps, what could help bring this along to better comply with the existing character of the estate district. I know it's foreseen as kind of a equestrian area. I was looking at the photos. I could see maybe if we added a white fence along the boundary of North Avenue, if that might improve the compatibility of the project with the estate district and its equestrian sort of vibes. So that's something that we're open to. If there's a condition of approval that the board might recommend. Next slide. And so, I guess to this one as well, if you can imagine a white fence there, maybe that's something that helps us along. And then from the community perspective standpoint, on February 8th, we introduced a host community benefit agreement. One of the comments that we heard is that this project won't provide much value to Antioch specifically. And while we did present a summary of the tax increase that the project will have, we heard you that might not be enough, and the project would potentially create an administrative burden for the village. So we proposed a host community benefit agreement that would provide the village with $7,000 per megawatt that would be due to the village at the time of commercial operation. So that's just an acknowledgement that there is some burden here associated with hosting the project and dealing with compliance related issues, et cetera.
Can you elaborate for the folks in the audience that we're talking about how I'd like you to actually answer a question here. So how does the village benefit monetarily from this? And can you explain for the folks how the residents, how many residents in Antioch would be able to benefit from this particular solar farm?
I believe, in terms of residents, I believe we projected that the project would generate enough electricity to power roughly, is it 500 homes? I can't remember.
Was it 500 or 523 or?
528.
Okay. And of those 528, it wouldn't not just be 528 residents in Antioch. It would be 528 customers of ComEd, correct?
Yeah, any customer within
any customer of ComEd.
Right. Subscriber.
Subscriber. So it would not just be residents of Antioch.
In
Lake County, right. Correct? Would it be just Lake County or would it be
ComEd?
Okay. Okay, so it would not just be exclusively to Antioch residents. Okay.
We got somebody on the
Sorry. Yeah. So it's not, so the way the community solar subscription service works in Illinois is that it's open to the distribution network. And that would be the ComEd distribution network. Now, anybody can go online and subscribe to the project. And if it's 500 residents from Antioch that do so, then that's great. That's the way it works.
But it may not be.
But it may not
be. Okay. Right. Mm-hmm. And then, as far as the municipality, what is the monetary benefit to Antioch?
With the property tax increase, one, and that's the fair market value assessment of $218,000 per megawatt. And I think the very last slide in the deck has some modeling. The
increase. What is the 7,000? What is that?
Oh, so that's the community benefit agreement. So this is something new and different.
Okay, so what is that?
So that's in addition to the property tax increase. The community benefit agreement that has been circulated is a contract between the developer and the village. And it's not dependent on the zoning entitlement. So we understand that the village retains all authority to grant zoning entitlement or not. But if it grants the zoning entitlement, when the project hits commercial operation, at that point, then the project will pay to the village a donation fee in the amount of $7,000 per megawatt.
Okay.
How many megawatts?
That, yeah. Is it? Yeah.
2.85. So I think the slide calculates that.
19,950.
Yeah, 19,950.
Is that a one-time fee or how does?
One-time fee.
One-time fee, okay.
And that has been, so that's a document that's common among communities that host community solar like this in Illinois. And that is this version of it, this offer,
okay,
was given to the.
Okay, and so then when you say the property tax fee, so the property's valued at $219,000. So that you're saying then they get the property tax per year for a property of $219,000.
Ben, can you jump to that slide? Would you mind, Madam Chair?
No,
he's got a slide on it.
I just want the folks who are here that understand. Yeah.
Can we make that bigger?
For
again, I feel like I'm at the eye doctor, like E. You want it bigger?
So also,
I can see it, but I don't know.
And it's in the.
It's in the packet. Okay.
Okay, but the audience can see it.
Yeah, we want to make sure the audience can see it, even though I think many of them are part of your team.
But there are some.
I know.
Community members there.
Yeah.
So the way the property taxes work in Illinois, it's statutory. It's valued at a fair market value assessment of $218,000 per megawatt. That is then applied a CPI index and an equalizer so that you have your assessment at the end. This slide has modeled what the property is currently assessed at and what the property would be assessed at with the solar farm. Now you can see, you know, if you go down to the bottom, and this is annual, you know, the total taxes currently generated is, you know, $3,033. What will be generated, $27,910 in the first year. The Village of Antioch admittedly is a low taxing body. So, you know, great for Antioch residents, you know, $257 right now. Mm-hmm. And eventually it'll get, you know, another $2,000. But the real jumps are to the school districts. You know, school districts
always
are always the biggest ones. Mm-hmm. So you can see there, you know, 10X to the District 34 and about the same 10X to District, you know, 117. So that's, you know, tangible. And yeah, and no further resources, you know, used by the school. So it's free money.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Great. Thank you.
Yeah. The additional benefits in addition to then the subscription model, which, you know, is open to anybody who can go online and get it, property taxes and the community benefit agreement, whatever's negotiated between the village and the developer.
Can you please talk into this?
Would be also, you know, there's construction jobs, local construction jobs that can be generated from the project. And then, yeah, access to renewable energy.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Ben. Okay, so the other thing that we did to try and better understand the local community and the sentiment towards solar broadly, as well as this project specifically, we worked with a company called Embold Research to do a survey of residents, and they were able to obtain a representative sample based on the population
About 300 people responded to this survey. And the results of that showed that there's a plurality of residents who support community solar in Antioch. Those who support, it's not, you know, sort of falls down party lines here. Tends to be, supporters tend to be among younger residents, those with a college degree, and Democrats. But I think what was most interesting from the survey was that for those who were opposed, they were most likely opposed because they felt that the project might have an adverse effect on local wildlife and farmland. And so brought up the agrivoltaics as a potential opportunity to address that. And we have Carl on the in the hearing tonight to address the wildlife concerns. So next slide. And then finally, you know, we, as I mentioned, we had some team of folks on the ground here in Antioch going door to door, trying to understand the local perspective. We've submitted a petition of supporters to the record this evening. And I understand that while the gentlemen were out chatting with folks, they ran into a village board member and a PZB member. And so I apologize for that.
Excuse me, they were at my house.
Oh, okay.
But I'd like the council to speak to that.
Yeah, if you want to finish your sentence now. Yeah, I know you're in the middle. Yeah, and then I'll jump in.
No, I apologize. That's not something that, you know, we had planned on or would, you know, like to see it happen. That we got ahead of our skis on that one, and I apologize for.
No need to apologize. I mean, the board wants an apology. Just the couple things I want to put on the record that we did not see the questions. I don't know what the questions were. And I don't know what this, you said you had 300 people. I don't know what the, again, I was not very good at statistics. I guess that's why I went to law school. But I don't know if 300 is a necessarily representative number or the geographic diversity of what is kind of a spread out village. And where the pollsters, having sent out people to do signatures, you normally send them in dense places to get the most signatures, just of a pure efficiency thing. So I don't want to say peer reviewed is the way to say it, but we don't have any controls at the village level of what was in the survey or where the petitions were at. So I just don't want to give the impression that this was like a scientific survey or anything like that. We appreciate you hearing. We appreciate you fact finding. And I think I could speak for the board on that, that it's always good when a petitioner hears the concerns of the board. But to say, well, we did not know what the questions were, we did not know where they went, and we don't know what the stratas were that would normally go into like a study or scientific type of analysis of that. So I think that's fair.
Sure. Yeah, I can... I did submit the results, the full.
Sure. Yeah. No, and it's appreciated. Right. But I just want to make sure we're clear that it's fair. But again, no need to apologize. We understand it was from a place of good heart, for lack of a better word. But I guess that's just the standards by which they went. So please proceed. Sorry.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Let's see. So I guess that's actually, I was going to turn it over now to Mike from TRC, Mike Butler. He's going to address the decommissioning and stormwater questions that we've heard post-PZB meeting.
Excellent. Great. Thanks. Mike Butler, TRC, I'm a professional engineer and civil engineer in the state of Illinois. And like Brian mentioned, just wanted to address a couple of the items that were brought up in the last meeting and kind of subsequent. One was just the decommissioning plan, kind of explain what it is and what its intent is. So that is a plan that we as an engineer, civil engineer, put together, review, stamp, that lays out how when the project does reach the end of its useful life, 10, 15, 20, 35 years, how it's going to be disassembled, what's going to be removed, and what the cost of that looks like. So
The real simple answer is everything's going to be removed. And I'll talk about a little bit about the Illinois Department of Agricultural and Agricultural Impact Mitigation Agreement as well. But the plan explains how everything's removed and puts a cost to it. That is then bonded with the village so that in the absolute worst case, last resort scenario, renewable property isn't around to remove the project. But the village does have that bonded money to remove the everything. So, and like I said, that's governed by the Agricultural Impact Mitigation Agreement. That's an agreement between renewable properties, property owner, and governed by the Department of Agriculture that dictates how they're going to do construction and how they're going to remove the project with the intent that it's returned to its current state so that the current owner can, or the owner of the property at the time, can return it to agricultural use. So that drives how they do construction, when they do construction, what kind of controls have to be in place, how deep cables are buried, what kind of road and gravel surfaces can be put in. And then again, at the end of the life of the project, how everything comes out. And essentially, it's everything comes out. It's returned to its current condition. Yeah, so that's an agreement then and plan that's put together and that's bonded with the city. Or the village, sorry. On the stormwater side, I know there were also some questions about that. No, and compaction, yeah. I'll kind of walk through how the site is managed from that, from construction through completion. Well, maybe backwards here, but from the start of construction, we have a permit with the Illinois EPA, the Stormwater Pollution Prevention Plan, and a stormwater permit that dictates what kind of controls need to be in place the minute that site is disturbed to make sure there isn't increased runoff, either in volume or in silt and sediment being washed off, either into adjacent roadways, downstream streams, or wetlands. So that plan is in place from the minute construction starts, and that plan and permit stays in place until the vegetation is established. And I know one of the questions was about compaction during construction and would the seeding be effective? Would it grow? And the answer is it will. Part of the plan is 4 inches of new topsoil at the time to allow the seeds to grow. But there's also a lot of other things that are taken in. Straw, matting, a lot of other precautions taken to make sure that seed has a chance to get established. And that permit stays in effect until that vegetation is established. The state doesn't let that go. They're taking those permits very seriously for all development around the state. And then once everything is established and the native plants are there, you actually see a 10 to 20% net decrease in both runoff volume and velocities. So you see less water coming off the site, less sediment being carried off the site. And that's just simply the change from row crops to the native prairie planting. You know, they're bigger plants, more mass, they cover more area than a simple row crop, and they have a much greater root structure. They have a lot more infiltration, and they slow down water movement off the site. So, like I said, what you end up in the end is a 10 to 20% decrease in stormwater.
There you go. Is that during construction, while it's in development, or after construction when the decommission is in place, you put the soils back to native plants?
That is when it's in operation. Once the vegetation's been established, you know, six months down the line, once those native prairie plants have come into play. And in the meantime, until that time, that's all the erosion control, silt fencing, matting, all those steps that are put into place at the beginning of construction have to stay there for that stormwater permit until the vegetation's established.
And that's for the lifetime of the solar system in place, that vegetation is growing underneath.
Exactly, yep. And then that's maintained however it's decided to be maintained, whether that's mowed or with some friendly grazing animals or however.
Sheep. Four paw engines.
Mm-hmm. Jimmy's the answer.
There's been some debate whether detention is required or not based on the size of the site and impervious roof type reactions from the panels.
So Almost unanimously now, any of the jurisdictions aren't considering solar panels impervious. I guess the best way to describe it is more of an umbrella than a rooftop. So they're going to cover a certain amount of area, and the water is going to run off. And yes, it's going to run off in a concentrated area at that time, but it's still got the full area to infiltrate. You're not covering significant areas with concrete. You've got one concrete or one or two concrete pads where equipment's going to be, and you've got a gravel drive coming in. But it still has all of that area to infiltrate.
You also have driveways in between every row of the panels for people to service.
No, those are all grassed in. There is nothing. There's nothing left.
But they drive out. When you drive on grass, it compacts it.
But very, those are very infrequently. I mean, I would say that's going to get, especially if it's not mowed, twice a year to someone to go out and maintain a panel. The maintenance is pretty low, so you don't really see much compaction post construction.
Okay, great debate on this.
They tend to grow in pretty well. We've had a lot being built in Illinois, specifically in the last couple of years. So there's a lot of good examples out there.
Okay. Thank you. So Carl is up next. I'm not sure how we kick him off exactly, being on Zoom.
I'm going to see you logged in.
Yes.
Oh, he's not here. Is this
sworn in? No, did you? Carl, did you raise your right hand and prepare to be sworn when you were swearing everybody else in?
I certainly did, but I can do it again on camera.
Right, well, we can't see you. I mean, it's a lovely slide. But you're sworn and you acknowledge your oath?
Yes.
Yes, that's fine. He can proceed. Go ahead, Carl. You can proceed.
So thank you so much for having me today. I'll give a little background, and then Ben, we'll have to figure out how to do the slides because I'm viewing the boardroom and not the screen, but I think I can go through the content.
Yeah, Carl, just say next slide, and I'll just skip over to the next slide whenever you're ready.
Of course.
So right now, we're on your title slide.
Title slide. So I'm Carl Kostchik. I am a wildlife program manager at a consulting firm called Tetra Tech. I've been working in the wildlife renewable energy sector for about 17 years now. I have a master's degree in wildlife from Texas A&M University and a doctorate from Kansas State University. And I've published a few papers on how birds interact with solar facilities. So if we take a look at the first slide here, Ben, I'm going to start with my conclusions. And then I will go through a few slides to demonstrate how the data support these conclusions. First, the project will likely increase the species diversity in the project area in regards to birds. The project will not impact the bird utilization of red-winged slough or other nearby wetlands. And the project characteristics, including its small size, construction timeline, lighting characteristics, tracker panels that will be used, the vegetation maintenance and restoration, erosion and control, and the other water resources on the landscape will greatly reduce risk to birds. Next slide. So we'll start first by acknowledging IDNR had limited concerns about bird risk. In the letter they provided on December 19th, 2022, they recommended no work in the project area during the bird breeding season. And then they also stated that if the above recommendations are adopted, the department has determined that these impacts to protected resources are unlikely. So from a starting point, when I look at this project, we have the state agency saying that there is likely going to be no risk to birds. Next slide, Ben, with the box plots. But I'll present to you a few studies that support these conclusions. So just a few months ago in 2024, a paper was published entitled "Solar Parks Can Enhance Bird Diversity in an Agricultural Landscape." And I'll be brief about this, but if you look at the figure, in all cases, the yellow box, which is the solar site, is higher than the blue box, which is the data in an agricultural environment. So bird richness, abundance, and diversity were higher at the solar facilities than in the ag sites, showing a benefit of the solar project development and restoration for bird diversity. Next slide, please. So I published a paper with colleagues back in 2020, where we did the first comprehensive review of bird mortality at solar sites in the US and in the world, really. And you might have seen this paper referenced before, but to provide the conclusions, most fatalities were common ground-dwelling birds that are often prey species. Most of the carcasses detected were in fall. This is kind of important here. There's no evidence of large-scale fatality events. And we hear about these bird fallout events and bird mortality events, maybe at some of the buildings in downtown Chicago, where they are birds are colliding with buildings and lighted structures at night during migration. We never found anything like that at a solar facility. And most of the evidence that was found was feather spots, just piles of small feathers on the ground. We weren't finding whole intact carcasses, which leads to some uncertainty as to what's causing this mortality. And that figure I've shown here is just gives you some ideas of sample sizes, you know, some sample size of 11, one project 274, one project of 7. So we did find some variability in the number of fatalities. Next slide. So briefly, we conducted another study and published a paper in 2021 looking at what types of aquatic birds might be attracted to solar facilities. And this is a good reference point for the size of the project. Pictured on this slide is Desert Sunlight. Desert Sunlight is a 550 megawatt facility over about 3,500 acres. And if you look at the panels in that image, those are fixed panels. This project was developed before tracker technology. And this is the project where we found most of those water birds like loons and grebes and rails. It was at Desert Sunlight. And I scaled the proposed Deep Lake Solar Project on Desert Sunlight to give you all an idea of the perspective of the size of Desert Sunlight compared to the proposed project under consideration. One thing to also note is that this project is on BLM land, and BLM never required further evaluation or mitigation because they determined that the impacts at this 550 megawatt facility were not significant impacts to bird populations. So all of this might be interesting, but you're thinking, Carl, you're talking about the desert in California. How does this relate to our area near Antioch? And so what we did was we summarized some data from studies in Alberta. And that prairie pothole region is more similar to the region we're discussing here. And so what I want to show in this figure, Ben, if you roll on to the Alberta figure, is that we have 11 solar facilities and we're dealing with very small sample sizes, 2, 6, 2, 9 fatalities over projects that are 25, 50, megawatts in size. So smaller than Desert Sunlight, but still not having really appreciable level of bird mortality. And let's take a look, Ben, at the next slide about the patterns in the species that we're detecting here. So when we look at the southwestern US, this is our desert studies. We find mourning dove, horned lark, house finch, western meadowlark, and American coot were the most common. And you might say to yourself, I see those birds all the time. These birds have populations in the millions, and they're ground-dwelling birds primarily. These are not nocturnal migrant songbirds. When we look at the Alberta data, we have gray partridge, mourning dove, mallard, red-winged blackbird, house sparrow, starling. These again, are birds with large population sizes. In the case of mourning dove and gray partridge, these are common prey species. So what do we take away from this data cumulatively? Well, we do find some bird carcasses at solar facilities. They're of common ground-dwelling birds with populations in the millions. We do not find large fallout events in terms of mortality. And we don't find agencies in like the BLM or CDFW, California Department of Fish and Wildlife, asking for more monitoring, even at the largest solar projects. So to wrap up there, Ben, going back to the conclusions, all of these conclusions are well supported by data. IDNR did not voice excessive concern or really any concern about bird risk or moreover habitat devaluation or loss of habitat value for red-winged slough. And I preserved this picture, which was in the DNR letter. And returning that landscape to a natural vegetated landscape, as the one study shows, could improve bird diversity and other metrics. So that's all I have today for my brief presentation. And thank you for the opportunity to speak with the board.
Madam Chair, could I ask Carl just a follow-up question?
Absolutely.
Dr. Kosic, could you again tell us when you obtained your PhD?
Oh, I got my PhD in 2006.
And you've been studying birds and impacts of infrastructure to birds since then?
Yeah, I've been a consultant working in this field since that time.
And how many peer-reviewed journal articles have you published on avian species and impacts?
So I've published two on bird mortality and diversity at PV Solar. And then I also published a paper about sage grouse occurrence, the first paper on sage grouse occurring at a photovoltaic facility.
Are those journal articles cited by other professionals in your field?
Oh, certainly. One way we measure our impact as a scientist is through citations. And it was pretty cool to see the 2020 bird mortality paper picked up by scientists in France, Saudi Arabia, and other countries around the world. So it's had a far-reaching impact.
Thanks, Carl. And we missed you being here live in person today. Where are you located at?
Oh, I live in Eagle, Idaho, just outside of Boise.
Thanks, Carl.
Thank you.
Dr. Carl, can I ask you a couple questions?
Certainly.
So you referenced BLM. What is BLM? Again, I am not familiar with any of this.
So Bureau of Land Management land in the Western U.S. So Bureau of Land Management manages millions of acres of land in the Western U.S. And Desert Sunlight was permitted on that land, which requires it to go through a NEPA process, National Environmental Policy Act, which subjects it to some scrutiny from other agencies.
All right, I got three more questions and then I will be done. Famous last words for a lawyer, right? So there is some talk about, I keep on hearing about the sheep that are going to serve as lawnmowers. If mm-hmm. the sheep come in, does it affect the birds at all or no?
Great question. So sheep grazing can be compatible with wildlife. And the thing is that what really helps wildlife value is the underlying vegetation. So a good restoration, revegetation plan will provide benefit. And that sheep grazing is seasonal. So the bird use and activity will undoubtedly increase over an agricultural landscape.
You said that you wrote a paper about a sage grouse just for, yeah. I don't know, what's a sage grouse?
So sage grouse is a bird of keen conservation interest in the Western okay. U.S. And there is a lot of dialogue about sage grouse populations and energy development out here in like Idaho, Wyoming, Montana.
I really want to ask if you decided to move to Eagle, a place with Eagle on there based on your academic background, but I will refrain from that. Hey.
That is an ongoing joke in this family.
Thank you. I'll be here all night.
Not lost on us.
All right. So this is probably the most important one. So in Lake Michigan, they introduced a fish and it started eating all the other fish. In Yellowstone, they introduced gray wolves and it took out the elks by like the dozen. And I think in San Francisco, they introduced hawks and instead of eating pigeons, it ate everybody's parakeets. You said that the introduction of these solar panels would bring a more diverse bird population. Will that attract hawks, falcons, other predators, eagles, or any other animals that will hurt the animals that are naturally in our ecosystem? Or is that just a really dumb question?
No, it's a good. I liked your linkages to those previous changes in the ecosystem. So we think of it as returning to a more natural state. And I understand the importance of agriculture. I love food and I thank our farmers for working the land and providing what we have. But when we look at wildlife value through a wildlife lens, we see a different story of agricultural landscapes. And IDNR, I believe, mentioned this in their letter that removing some of the inputs and getting back to a natural landscape will be an improvement for wildlife. So think of it as we're getting back to a natural landscape in the vegetation composition. There will be some infrastructure there, but it's going to be a more natural landscape than what an agricultural landscape can offer.
I don't have anything else, Madam Chair. I don't know if any of the board members do or anything.
Yes, if you could just hold on a moment, let me ask if the fellow commissioners would have some questions for you. And I'll start with Mr. Ryan, who is remote.
None at this time.
Ms. Sanfilippo?
I have nothing at this time.
Mr. McCarty?
It poses the question when you say natural landscape, and you have solar panels mounted above it, how that's a natural landscape. I understand that the vegetation could be more natural to our area that we're putting in place rather than an agricultural setting, but it certainly doesn't seem natural with solar panels above it. It's kind of an oxymoron. All right. Enough for my comment. Yep.
Mr. Turner?
I don't have anything.
And I do not either. Absolutely.
Again, from a layperson, migration patterns. Does this matter? Does it affect it? Geese, duck. We have a lot of geese, it seems, around here. But if you could just address migration or any changes or any effect on it with this use.
Certainly. So when we look at the data from Alberta, there is lots of waterfowl. Cranes move through the area, the prairie pothole region, grassland agricultural matrix. What we see is that there's not a lot of mortality risk. Birds do occur inside solar facilities in some capacities where there's space between the panels and the fence. What I would not expect is any disruption of flight patterns. Our study from California, where we had some sites way down in the Imperial Valley, showed that birds flew over the solar project all the time en route to their foraging activities. So it's not as though this area would be buffered out from migrating birds.
So it wouldn't negatively impact the flow of your migratory birds to the slough during the season and reduce them and or increase them due to the solar panels being on this property right next to it.
Are you asking the question?
I am.
You may not have heard you.
Carl, did you get that question?
Was it about changes to the bird?
You mentioned the mortality rate, but you didn't mm-hmm. mention how it could possibly change the amount of birds that are in the area or use the area for their migratory purposes. I understand they fly over it, but that doesn't mean that they're gonna land in the area, stay here for a while like they do now, or if they're just gonna pass by because they don't have, you know, that's not part of their natural landscape anymore.
Certainly. So it's worth considering, especially in regard to the neighboring wetlands. There's no study or evidence to suggest that birds would be displaced. So I think there's two concepts. There's avoidance and displacement. So would birds avoid Red Wing Slough or the nearby wetlands that provide valuable habitat? No evidence to suggest they would. In fact, we expect there to be no disruption in their use of the area. Would they be displaced from the project area? Possibly. But right now, the project area likely has lower value to wildlife given the current land use practices. So I think that when we look at the data that we have about bird activity in PV solar and the IDNR perspective, we would not expect any reduced use or value for the neighboring wetlands or Red Wing Slough.
Any further questions?
I've heard the words likely and possible. And the fact that we don't have the study to back up the use of like red-winged slew for our migratory birds and whether it's going to impact them being here, staying here, using the area, and then flying on is still a large question. I appreciate your input. Thank you.
All right. Madam Chair.
Yes.
So we had submitted Dr. Kostchik's report to the record. I don't think I have a hard copy with me, but it's in the record, and I believe it was supplied. I just want to read from his conclusions that he had on his presentation. He had some sub-bullets in the report directly addressing this issue, and I just want to verify it with Dr. Kostchik on the record here. He wrote, birds that use the red-winged slew and other nearby wetlands will likely move over the project area and continue using the red-winged slew and other wetlands. We do not expect birds to avoid the area after the project is constructed. And I just want to ask Dr. Kostchik if he is certain of that to a reasonable degree of professional certainty in his field, which is the best standard that we can do when we analyze these types of issues. So Dr. Kostchik, could you just confirm that for us here?
That is confirmed.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Doctor.
Thank you.
Okay.
Next we have Drew, but I wanted to acknowledge, I heard Mr. McCarty's concerns last time, and we wanted to provide Carl as a resource to try and answer your questions. And I recognize that red-winged slew is an important ecological attribute to the community, and so I hope that Carl was helpful in answering any questions. So Drew is here to talk about property values.
Okay, thank you.
Hey, good evening. Thank you so much. I'll try to be quick. That's a picture of me. Andrew Lines, I'm your local State of Illinois appraiser. I've been appraising here for over 20 years. Originally started my career at Equity Residential Properties, moved on to the appraisal field. I've done a lot of impact studies. I think you guys previously heard from Patricia McGar, who's also an MAI and a counselor of real estate, like myself. And we've been looking at impacts of a wide variety of properties, including landfills and quarries, waste transfer stations. I've worked on big box retail developments. Most recently, I was highlighted for some work I did regarding Ryan Fields in Evanston, and I continue to do a lot of different kinds of work. But for the last 7 years, I've been very focused on renewable energy projects and specifically solar, both in the state of Illinois as well in other states. I've been accepted as an expert in 15 different states, and here in Illinois, probably 23 counties. Next slide. So just continuing on the animal train, I wanted to talk to you guys about horse farms. So I'm very well acquainted with Lake County, and I know that and McHenry County, and I know there are a lot of horse enthusiasts. I'm one myself. And so there should be some concern. Okay, what are horses going to be like next to solar? And more importantly, what about horse businesses? So I was able to contact the owner of the Sundance Riding Stables in a little community just west of Lansing in central Michigan. It's a pretty recreational and exurban area in central Michigan. Ms. Patterson told me that the proximity to the solar panels is not deter customer attraction to their recreational, agricultural, and destination use. And she indicated that the panels she uses as a directional enhancement to make sure that people arrive at her farm and that there were absolutely no issues with horses at all. I also was part of an application that was recently approved in Will County that is next to a very large horse farm and stables. And there were also no issues or challenges there. Next slide. And I think Pat had spoken about this with you, and I want to just take it a little bit deeper. This is with regards to what was a somewhat agricultural area about 40 minutes from Chicago to the southeast in Porter County, which is in the path of development. It's not unlike Antioch in that regard, and where we're seeing a lot of new development occurring. And so originally, there were just a couple of big open agricultural fields, and someone put a very considerable size solar farm, very consistent with the one that's proposed here at about 2.5 megawatts. And there was a house that was built about 1,000 feet away. And that one was built in 2018 for about $465,000. Pretty big estate house, pretty nice for the area at the time. And now since that time, Lennar has come in and they're putting in a pretty big production subdivision. Next slide. So there's just some additional details here that I think are relevant. If proximity is our best proxy for determining whether or not there is a negative impact to homes, the ones that are the closest to the solar farm would likely show the most negative impact. But as you can see behind me in the exhibit itself, it's a little tough to see, but where that picture is where the solar farm is. It is to, we are north facing, so the solar farm would be to the east. This is a picture that I took of a home that sold, and that home sold for about $400,000. The home just north of it, which also backs up to the solar farm, sold for $405,000. And then one at the corner in that kind of nice big, probably the biggest lot, sold for $426,000. Again, all those homes back up to the solar farm, and there is zero screening between the homes themselves and the pre-existing solar farm. So again, these homes have been built since the solar farm has been there, not the other way around. When we look at sales data from the rest of the subdivision, and I just snapped this from the Northern Indiana MLS, but you can see that sales that have occurred throughout the subdivision, and I talked to Lennar, and they expect to be completely sold out by the summer. They're building like they're just mad and building right there. But you can see that the other sales that have occurred within the subdivision that are less proximate away from the solar farms and ones that have no view of the solar farm itself are actually selling for less dollars. I've looked at the homes, they're all pretty much comparable homes, 4 bedrooms, 2 baths, about 2,300 square feet. I understand that they're production homes and not necessarily big, large estate homes, but it is pretty clear evidence that the solar farm itself, it is already there, is not necessarily deterring customers from buying homes or from spending good hard-earned money on a home that's next door. So no fears there. I'll say that I've been doing this a while. I've looked at hundreds of different solar farms. I've spoken with dozens of brokers and market participants who are actually familiar with homes that sell next to solar farms, as well as dozens of county assessors in 15 different states. And they're all telling me the same thing. I had a presentation for McHenry County about 6 years ago. It was the first time that they had entertained their very first application for a solar farm in McHenry. And they had asked me, would you please do a before and after analysis? Because we're still kind of concerned about this. And so I did it and I came back and I presented the evidence and they were extremely thankful. And I just beg you, if you are having any concerns about this still, I'm here, let me leverage, please leverage me, use my brain and all the facts and figures that I've looked at over the last 7 years on this. I'm ready to help you. I'm here if you have any questions and appreciate your time.
I have a question. So given the market right now that, supply and demand and that there's not much out there, is it more desirable that, these houses, so what if there's a solar farm? I need a home and there's nothing there. So yeah, I'm going to buy it. I don't care if there's a solar farm. Does that have any effect on it?
So there's a couple things. So one is when we do our studies, we're very sensitive to time. So we want to make sure that we're analyzing the same market conditions from the first sale in our survey to the last sale in our survey. So we try to make sure that we're looking within a 12 to 16 month period, understanding that sometimes, major interest rate increases or dips can have that, effect on home sales. But we use the FHFA index to bring all of those transactions back to the same date. So we're effectively looking, when we do our little snapshots of surveys, that all the homes that we're considering in our survey are being sold on the same date. In instances where we have data from subdivisions, we did an analysis outside of Indianapolis, another production home subdivision. Well, it had been around for 7 or 8 years. So what we did is we took snippets of, a 2-year time period 2-year time period and a 2-year time period to make sure that we are capturing the differences within those market conditions.
So in other words, you went back maybe 6 years and looked at a 2-year time period, 2 years. Okay.
Yep. So we tried to make sure that we understood, okay, this is what everybody's doing in this market condition. Absolutely, over the last 3 years, there's been considerable ramp up in areas where normally you wouldn't see many home sales at all, like a massive pop. It's been great for some people. I'm happy about that. But I do have data and evidence showing that homes that are next to solar are being sold at an amount that's greater than the entire county. So we have an example of a home that is on a, it's on a 10-acre homestead. And there are 4 homes that are surrounded by solar on 4 sides. So it's a group of homes, solar on 4 sides, no screening. It's a 100-megawatt facility. It's the largest one in the Midwest that was built at that time. It's called the North Star facility. And one of the homes, it's a split-level home. Again, it's on a nice 10-acre property. It's about 25 minutes north of the Twin Cities. And it sold on a per square foot value, the highest of any other split home in that area. We confirmed that with the county. So we're seeing evidences that still, no matter what, these things are selling for hotcakes. I mean, it's just not an issue. It's just not an issue. I wish it was. I wish I could tell you differently, but we're just not seeing it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Does anyone else have a question? Mr. Turner? Mr. McFadden? Mr. Ryan?
None at this time.
Okay.
The final act.
Okay.
I promised Jimmy we would keep this at 20 minutes, so I am sorry, Jimmy.
It's fine.
You don't have to. No apologies.
This is 20 minutes.
Yeah.
Really? Okay.
No, the entire presentation.
Oh, okay.
Not my part.
Okay. Well, you didn't keep your promise.
Mm-hmm. Closing.
The closing.
Otherwise known as the final act.
The final act. Elf theme. Thank you very much again for your time tonight. This was a remand. It wasn't a redo. We know that. We came here hopefully with specific additional information that this board had requested or discussed, and that the village board had requested or discussed. That was the intent here. I hope that you see that and you don't feel like we've you know, wasted your time. We did make an effort to keep this limited and to move quickly. And I think the information presented here was really important for this board's consideration and for the village's consideration. You met me last time, Ben Jacoby. I'm the attorney for the developer here. And so my role in closing here is to discuss briefly, and I will be brief, the factors, the elements that you'll be considering for the variance for the special use and how the evidence presented before and presented today meets those factors. But I want to be very specific about this. And I want to pay homage to Mr. Garrigan. He did a great job on the staff report, we felt. And we wanted to address some of the things that were in the staff report. The conclusion of his staff report this time included findings of fact and an alternative version of findings of fact that were all in the negative. And we felt it important to address that, to respond to that, and to provide an alternative version, the applicant's version of findings of fact for your consideration. That's relatively common in here like this. It hopefully makes your work a little bit easier if you agree with us. And if you don't, at least you've seen on the record our take on the evidence in a concise format. And we go to the first slide. Thank you. So your variance ordinance has your variance ordinance has 4 elements and your special use has 2. The staff's report goes through each one of these Madam Chair, I can provide an extra.
Would you mind?
Yeah.
It says alternative findings.
The last part. But it's okay.
Oh, maybe I do have it then. Yeah. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I do.
No. So there's two pieces of paper that I think will be helpful to show you. One is that I just handed to Madam Chair, which is titled Closing. This is the last section of our PowerPoint presentation. And then the second is staff's report that I know you've been provided. And what I've done for our findings of fact is I've lined up certain elements from staff's report that we think believe support the findings of fact. And then there's other, you know, evidence that has been in the record that also supports the findings of fact. I'm gonna focus mainly on staff's report. I think it was really accurate in a lot of ways. And I wanted to tie in staff's report to the findings of fact for this board's consideration. And that first finding of fact for your variance is the variance is in harmony with the general purpose and intent of this title. And I took two quotes right out of the staff's report that support this particular element. And I have them highlighted there. The first is that the staff's report notes solar farms are a special use in the estate district because, quote, based on their low impact on adjacent parcels, staff makes that determination. This is consistent with your comprehensive plan, which according to the staff report, quote, identifies the subject site as low density, which is appropriate for large estates, estate lots or uses that don't have large impacts on land. So stated another way, the solar farm is the low impact on adjacent parcels that the estate district is looking for. The solar farm is consistent with your estate district in that way, and that comes right out of staff's report. We think that was really important to highlight. Staff's report also says, this quote, as previously highlighted by staff, the Red Wing Slough is owned by the Illinois Department of Natural Resources, and they have expressed no objections to the proposed use of the subject site as a solar farm. So again, consistent with the harmony, you know, isn't the variance that you're granting, by the way, this is the variance to the half mile setback to wetlands and natural environmentally sensitive areas, specifically the Red Ring Slough here. The variance is in harmony with the general purpose and intent of the title because the IDNR has expressed no objections to the proposed use. That's in support of that factor. We've also noted here for your consideration, Dr. Kostchik's report and the former testimony of Haley Preston formerly at the last hearing. And I won't go into that in detail. I know we're not here to discuss those facts that came up at the last hearing, but I have them here too for your consideration. And then going on to the second page, we have another quote from staff. After reviewing the proposed landscape plan, the subject site will not be visible from traffic on North Avenue or the single family home to the once the landscape planted begins to mature. So again, brings the site within the harmony of the general purpose and intent of the title. And we also heard today, which is new, that the developer is prepared to not only put up the lavish screening, but also put up the horse fence, you know, to preserve that character. It'll all look the same out there with that nice white picket fence. Second factor, the plight of the owner is due to unique circumstances, and thus strict enforcement of this title would result in practical difficulties or impose exceptional hardships due to the special and unusual conditions that are not generally found on other properties. Staff's report was pretty clear on this. Staff confirms that the solar ordinance, as quote, as drafted generally, prohibits solar farms from being in any location close to the village based on the requirement that any solar farm be prohibited from being located within a half mile of any ecologically sensitive area. Staff report goes on, quote, based on the current solar ordinance, any solar farm would potentially require a variance because they could not locate almost anywhere within the village. Any solar farm would require a variance. This buffer requirement is unique to solar farms, staff notes, and does not apply to other commercial or M2 manufacturing. And that's consistent with a map that we showed you at the last hearing, which shows a buildable area for solar farms. There is none in the village with this particular setback. On the next slide, you know, I danced around this quite a bit. I think this is worthy of noting. The plight of the owner is unique to it here because this particular setback constitutes exclusionary zoning. There's no other way around it. There is no way to build a permitted use solar in this town without a variance, and that constitutes exclusionary zoning under the Illinois Supreme Court. It has to be put on the record And that is what creates a practical difficulty for the owner here. And that is why we ask the variance. Number three, the property cannot yield a reasonable use if permitted only under the conditions allowed by this title. Again, staff notes that the site, that the site is zoned estate. It could potentially attract residential development to the site, but the landowner has been unable to sell the land to a residential developer. I also note here that there's no utilities on the property, which makes residential development challenging and expensive. So in addition to other evidence in the record, we highlight that straight from staff's report that supports this element as well. I also just want to note that at the end of the life of the project, at the end of the 35 years, the land can be reverted to agriculture, and it can be developed for residential at the landowner's discretion. And one possibility is to put a cap on this special use permit to allow a 35-year life or expiration of the special use permit to ensure just that. Number four, this is the last element of the variance criteria. The variance, if granted, will not alter the essential character of the locality. It will not be substantial detriment to adjacent property. And that highlighted first bullet, another quote straight from staff's report under this very section, as staff report states, quote, after reviewing the proposed landscape plan, the subject site will not be visible from traffic on North Avenue or the single family home to the north once the landscape planted begins to mature. You know, staff has taken all this into consideration. It issued its findings as to each one of these elements, and staff's findings support granting of the variance. And that's all in the record. And those are the criteria that this board is tasked with analyzing here. And so we've asked, you know, we've asked that you consider those elements in your consideration. That takes care of the variance. The special use, same. So again, staff's report walks through the special use criteria, the two of them, and makes comment on them both. It makes comment in support of the special use criteria. So the first special use criteria is that the special use will not be injurious to the use and enjoyment of other property in the immediate area for the purposes already permitted, nor substantially diminish property values within the neighborhood. And we just heard Mr. Lyons talk about property values. But staff's report goes on to say, quote, as highlighted above, there are two residences to the north, one resident to the west of the proposed site. The applicant's the applicant is incorporating a 40-foot landscape buffer along North Avenue and planting 93 trees along the frontage. In addition, an 8-foot screened fence is being proposed to be located behind the proposed landscaping. This proposed landscaping buffer will provide 100% opacity and block any views from single-family homes located to the north. Staff's finding. Staff also says to the west is an existing tree line, and the applicant is proposing a 40-foot landscape buffer and extensive landscaping adjacent to that single-family homes, those single-family homes to the west. And finally, staff states, based on the foregoing, there is nothing to indicate that the proposed solar farm with the outlined landscape buffering will have any negative impacts on the adjacent parcel. The proposed solar farm will not be visible from these properties and will be completely screened. There's just no better way to say it. I completely agree with staff's report on this. I include a few more bullets here with Dr. Kostchik's and Ms. Preston's, Pat and Drew's testimony. They all also support this bullet, but staff's conclusion is just the best way to put it. And the second and final element of your special use permit ordinance is that the establishment of the special use will not impede the normal and orderly development and improvement of the adjacent properties for uses permitted in the subject zoning district. Staff again states the proposed solar farm is identified as a special use in the estate district, and special uses are presumed to be permitted unless one can demonstrate that the proposed use will have a negative impact on adjacent properties. So presumed to be permitted unless there's a negative impact. And then staff states, with the proposed screening of the subject site, the proposed solar farm will not be visible from adjacent properties. Based on this fact, there is nothing to indicate that the approval of the solar farm would impede future residential interest in the area. Specifically, based on staff's review of the application, there is no evidence of any negative externalities being caused by this proposed solar farm. Staff says it better than I ever could myself. Staff's statements, the evidence that you've heard, it supports the criteria for variance, special use, that's what we're here for today. We really appreciate your consideration of the additional evidence. The remand, we know it's extra time, but it's important for our project. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
The chair, we did receive a electronic mail correspondence, which I am prepared to read in, and I believe has been circulated to everyone. If Madam Chair could swear me in, or Madam Chair or Madam Recording Secretary could swear me in. Even though I am an officer of the court, I'd rather take the oath.
Please raise your right hand.
Yes.
You swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I so swear.
Okay.
So this is from a jfutterman@yahoo.com. And I'll just read it directly. Ms. Romine and Mr. Gutschow, I would like to enter a public comment in lieu of personal appearance at the upcoming Planning and Zoning Board meeting scheduled for March the 6th, 2024 in regards to PZB 2318, the solar farm proposal. Dear members of the Planning and Zoning Board, I am writing in support of permitting the solar farm. In February, we had 11 tornadoes touchdown in Chicagoland, including one that tore a roof off an apartment building in Mundelein. There had only been one tornado in February since the records have been kept in Chicagoland. As weather becomes more extreme, it is critical that we have a resilient energy system. Locally situated generation, such as community solar, is an important part of keeping our community safe. Community solar saves money for residents. Solar is a cheaper way to generate electricity. I have it on my rooftop and essentially have no electric bill. Not everyone has a suitable roof. Many people rent, live in multifamily housing, or have a roof that wouldn't work due to shading or other issues. Electricity expenses can really add up. Community solar allows everyone to access the lower cost of energy that solar provides. I think the solar field could be a source of community pride. It will be generating tax revenue for the schools. Clean energy jobs are a huge growth area. Our nation needs thousands of more electricians, HVAC technicians, and engineers. Having a solar field in the area could be a tangible example and inspiration for the youth who might be considering entering one of these fields. I understand that there are concerns about the proximity of the proposed location to the wetlands immediately to the south. I believe the solar installation would be a net benefit. There are stories circulated on social media about the dangers, in quotes, of solar panels. That is social media. The world-renowned scientists at Argonne National Lab and Underwriters Laboratory, both Illinois institutions, support the safety of solar. The Sierra Club, which in Lake County focuses on healthy waters with their Manitou Creek, M-A-N-I-T-O-U Creek, and Des Plaines Watersheds initiatives, supports solar in this situation. Of greater concern to the wetlands would be any fertilizer or pesticide runoff from the current use of the parcel. With solar in place, lower maintenance and plants can flourish and provide safe, sheltered nesting sites for waterfowl. I encourage you to support the permitting of this project. Thank you for your time and consideration. Sincerely, Jay Futterman. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Okay. So now we go back. I'm looking for...
Do you want to deliberate?
Yes, I do. So, do we want to...
Yeah, you can, if you want to just create a formal break, you could ask for a motion to open deliberations on the topic. There's nothing wrong with that. That happens in a lot of public.
Okay, areas. So yeah, I think that would be good. So, a motion.
Yeah, you'd ask for a motion to open deliberations on this matter.
Okay, so I would like a motion to open deliberations on the matter of the solar farm.
I'll make a motion to open up deliberation.
Do I have a second? Firm. Hello?
Second.
Okay. Roll call.
Brian?
Yes.
Sam Flippo?
Yes.
Hardy?
No.
Turner?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. Let's deliberate. Mr. Ryan?
I just have, the only thing I have to say is, you know, we talked about all these other aspects of it, but I get back to the first basic question is this project viable without subsidies? And the answer keeps coming back is no. So, you know, just as a community, why do we want to be subsidizing a project that costs the taxpayers money? That just gets back to my first, to the basic question. Like I said, I've been working on solar projects now for, the first one I worked on was in 1978. And in 1978, they weren't feasible to build a solar project by on its own accord. Here we are 45 years later, and we still can't build a solar project based on its own economic value. So those are my comments.
Ms. Sanfilippo?
I don't have anything.
Mr. McCarty?
I think I've made enough
comments. Okay. Mr. Turner?
I just had a couple questions for just clarity. In the closing statements there, it was stated that the buffer was 40 feet, and I heard earlier it was 30 feet. So just for clarity for the record.
Staff's report says 40 feet. I think the landscaping is 30 feet and the buffer is 40 feet total. So there's a difference between the, is that right? Okay, so Mr. Garrigan confirmed. So there's, you know, 10 feet, then the landscaping, or maybe it's landscaping, then 10 feet. And the,
okay.
So 40 feet from the property.
Okay. Question regarding the survey that was sent out. So you said 300 people had responded. Mm-hmm. Over the night, if the numbers were up there, I apologize, I couldn't see it. And I was trying to flip through the mountain of papers I have over here. How many were in favor of the three out of the 300?
Brian would know.
Out of the responses? Just curious.
So it was roughly a split in terms of the outcome, in favor and opposed. What the results showed is there is a plurality of support, which when you broke it down between strongly support, oppose, and strongly oppose, there was roughly, I think, 48% that fell into a category of support, and then the remainder being opposition. So not a statistician or interpreter of those kinds of results, but plurality of support.
Okay. And then I think just again, I think it's there is some confusion, I think, in the community, in the room, within the statement that was given, Mr. Vasily had read to us, around who gets the power, right? And I know that you guys had answered some of that a little bit more, but just to kind of go into it a little bit more clearly, mm-hmm. how the structure works, how it backfeeds the grid, who's actually getting that power. And then a follow-up question to that, it just goes alongside of it. Last time I think I asked, and if you guys had answered it, I apologize, I might have forgotten, a question around if community grids or the community solar programs, can businesses sign up? So we were talking about how it's 525 homes, give or take. If Walmart signs up tomorrow, right, how does that impact? And are they able to in the program? Just question, follow up there. So
yeah, so I'll start with the first, the last question first. Businesses can sign up. However, in order to qualify as a community solar project, no more than 40% of the electricity can be sold to any one offtaker. So Walmart can't just come in and take all the electricity. You know, they have to offer it to it, and its purpose is to diversify electricity for people who want to participate in programs like this. I will tell you, as an attorney who practices almost exclusively in energy, I'm in the energy practice group, I'm a shareholder at my firm, those types of companies enter into long-term, much larger power purchase agreements with power generators that can produce their needs. They're not going after 1 or 2 megawatts and in this case, it'd be like a half of a megawatt. Mm-hmm. It's just not feasible. They would have a million contracts all over the country. So they'll enter into a contract with somebody who, like a wind farm downstate that's creating 300 megawatts. That's what they're after. They're not after things like this. Your local businesses can sign up and take power from this project, as can any other residents and technically any other business. But nobody can take more than 40%. So the rest is open to everybody else.
But a business could sign up for 40% of it, which I don't want to do math in public. It's always a bad idea, right? But that's over a megawatt, right? 2.8.
Yeah.
40% wouldn't be half a megawatt. It'd be over a megawatt. A big industrial facility in Mundelein could sign up, mm-hmm. right? So they could take 40% of it. That solar field, and I know the answer, but I want to make sure everyone understands that solar field's not generating the power for that Mundelein plant, correct?
That's right.
Okay.
Yeah. So the way, you know, electricity works on a very basic level, and I'm not an electrician, you know, I'm just a lawyer who talks about it a lot. You know, electrons enter the grid and then they leave the grid through a path of least resistance. Mm-hmm. So they generally stay here. You know, the electrons produced by this project will generally stay here in this area. The markets that we're talking about, who's selling and who buying and who's buying electricity, that takes place in sort of a theoretical, you know, a marketplace where somebody buys electricity and somebody sells electricity. It all goes into a distribution grid and then it's distributed out, you know, basically to whoever's closest based on those contracts. So the subscription model that we've talked about is how community projects operate in Illinois. It is how they're bankable. It is how they are viable without the types of incentives that you would normally see with gas and nuclear. And by the way, gas, nuclear, coal, all energy gets incentives. Solar gets some tax credits through the IRA from the federal government to put it on equal playing ground. Otherwise, you know, all energy gets this. Otherwise, it wouldn't be able to compete against nuclear, which is essentially subsidized entirely by the state. So, you know, setting that issue aside for a moment that I just had to touch on, the consumers of this project will be people within ComEd grid, ComEd distribution network. So generally Northern Illinois. You go online in order to buy from this project. You can go online. The Citizens Utility Board has a lot of projects up that are like kind of compared one against each other. This company, the operating company, will hire a third party company to sell subscriptions, and they will sell subscriptions through a number of ways, through mailings and through, you know, online outreach. Generally, they like to outreach in local areas because people are interested in buying from local electricity, but they don't have to. They're really interested in getting subscriptions. That's their job. So they go out and they get subscriptions of people to fill the capacity of the solar project. And so once that happens, once they hit a critical mass of solar subscribers, then it becomes a bankable project, and it'll be approved by the utility to interconnect and begin producing electricity in exchange for money from the utility, which is then paid by the customers.
Okay. Thank you for all that clarity. It's confusing, right? Yeah. And it's a lot confusing to a lot of people. Follow-up question to that. So just for clarity, this solar field, if put in, does it make Antioch more resilient in a power outage?
Yeah. And we don't have, I think the engineers can probably testify as to that better than I can, but here's how it would generally work. Any infrastructure put in will enhance the grid generally where it's located. So by installing this project, are there any upgrades required with the substation? Okay. So the project will be required to install certain distribution lines from the project to the substation. I would actually be surprised if there aren't some substation upgrades required. They almost always are these days. But what happens is you have more wires, more infrastructure in the system. And what you're talking about in terms of resiliency, you know, reliability versus resiliency. Resiliency is when you have a critical event, like a weather event, that causes things to shut down, and how fast does it come back up? And having extra generation sources like this increases resiliency, because if one generator gets shut down, or if some lines are knocked down, then this generator remains in order to produce additional electricity. So if a tornado comes through and wipes out, the Radford wind farm in Macon, Illinois, and all of a sudden that electricity is not available to the grid. By the way, that's all privately purchased, so it's not part of this type of community outreach. But, you know, if a generator is wiped out, then, hey, there's some electricity here. It's small. It's 2.85 megawatts, which is a nameplate capacity. But you know, there's some electricity still available to pump into the grid in times of those urgent needs. In terms of reliability, which is a slightly different thing, what that means is that the system generally just is less prone to outages, and it increases reliability to that same extent that you're upgrading infrastructure that's already here. So if the substation requires some upgrades, if there's additional distribution lines installed and those are available for use, then that's the type of reliability that it would provide. And I don't know if I missed anything.
All right, I might be speaking. I'm sorry. I just had one more question regarding. So I might be speaking out of turn here, but so you guys are talking about 19,559. I don't remember the numbers, but yeah. It was 19,500.
Yeah.
So is there, have you ever seen this? Because you obviously have a ton of experience. You're talking about upgrading our substations, you know, for more resiliency. Have you guys ever done a dynamic where you've given back more money to the community to we could upgrade them?
Mm-hmm.
So then when that potentially catastrophic event happens, i.e. a microburst 2 years ago that knocked us out of power for a while, do you guys do that at all? You understand my question?
I think I do, and I'll reframe it a little bit. But so to be clear, I'm not certain that upgrades are required. Brian's telling me that they're not for the interconnection agreement. I'm sorry. Okay.
I'm just thinking offsetting, that's all.
Yeah, yeah. So reconductoring. So there are some upgrades to the extent that the conductors are being, replaced. Yeah, replaced. In order to handle the increased amount of power. What you're asking is, you know, can we provide money for the community to upgrade its substation on its own? Here's what I'll say. The substation's owned by the utility, ComEd. So ComEd's responsible for that. If ComEd needs upgrades there, then it will do them, and then it will charge them back to the customer. If we upgrade, and by the way, customer, I mean ratepayer, a.k.a. residents of Antioch. Correct. If we pay for the upgrades, those charges aren't passed on to the intaker. They're absorbed by the company because they're required for our project. So those types of upgrades would not be absorbed by ratepayers, like you or other residents of Antioch. It would be absorbed by our company. If you're asking whether there's other ways for us to contribute in order to make the community more resilient and more reliable in some ways, certainly worth discussing. We're open to discussion and resolution. I can't guarantee that we can provide money to upgrade a substation that only belongs to a public utility. That's a pretty complicated process for them to go through, in ways that would provide services that are different than what we require of our project. But there may be other ways for us to assist the community in being resilient to weather events.
So, can I add something, Mr. Commissioner, Madam Chair? And we don't want to negotiate, and I don't think this was ever your intent. We don't want to negotiate financial impacts on the floor, or, well, it was a very generous offer on the community benefits agreement for $7,000 a megawatt. If we get to that point, maybe the village comes back with a counteroffer for more money than $7,000. Well, we will not talk about that. This is not a financial board. This isn't our budget committee process. This is our zoning process. It is a process that deals with other factors for a special use permit and a variance met or not met. And does Illinois law allow us to go forward? That's all we're here to do tonight.
Thank you, Attorney Vaselli. And just to build on that, the community benefit agreement was for informational purposes here tonight. It has specific clause in it that says that zoning entitlements are not a quid pro quo for that community benefit agreement. We are not negotiating one for the other. It's conditioned, you know, we can't have a community we can't have a community benefit agreement unless we have a project, but we're not, you know, trading one for the other at this stage. But it has been discussed with the village, and it's worthy of continued discussion.
For any stage. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, and I have no further questions, and I appreciate you walking through the process because it's a lot, right? It's confusing, so thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I would like you to talk about a little bit about Hawthorne versus the Village of Olympia Fields.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was I'm remembering correctly, case with me, and I'll provide you a copy if you'd like. It was a daycare, I believe. Daycares are allowed use. They were allowed uses in Hawthorne Woods. And what Hawthorne Woods did was it enacted a zoning ordinance that essentially sort of like this setback, but slightly different because they used their zoning districts. But they essentially said, you're an allowed use in our community, but we're not gonna provide an avenue for you to actually build anywhere. And the appellate court found that that was exclusionary zoning and struck the requirement out of the zoning ordinance. So I don't want to get in, the purpose of that slide was twofold. I wanted to make sure that the board was aware, and I've discussed it with your attorneys in the past, so they're aware. And I wanted to make sure that was part of the factor consideration, because when you get down to whether this is whether it's a use that is when it's a use that's causing the landowner to the inharmonious use of the land. Pardon me for one moment.
It's okay. You say impose exceptional hardships due to the special and unusual conditions that are not generally found on other properties in the same zoning district.
That's right. Thank you very much. Exceptional hardship. So the exceptional hardship I was trying to describe, and you said it much better than me. So the exceptional hardship that I'm trying to describe is one that is imposed by a setback that doesn't allow zoning anywhere in the state. And if that setback were found exclusionary by a court, and we don't want to go there. But if a court were to find that setback exclusionary, then it would be struck from your ordinance altogether. We're trying to provide a way that we don't have to look for those types of options. We would like to work with the village.
I understand. I just wanted you to elaborate on the case.
Yeah.
And I think it's Olympia Fields. I think the petition. Yeah, I think it's Olympia Fields. Not. Yeah, but a DCFS case. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, there's two. That's the other one.
Yeah.
Well, this was Hawthorne versus Village of Olympia Fields.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And then there's. I think there's a similar case. Yeah. For Hawthorne Woods.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Okay. All right. So no further discussion. Okay. So now.
Do you want to say anything, Mike, or no?
Okay.
Okay. Okay. So at this point. Do we have a motion to renew?
Well, no. I mean, I think you want to close discussion. I mean, I don't want to sound like a wedding ceremony, but speak now or forever hold your peace. It doesn't mean you can't come back to it, but do you want to, does anyone else?
Is there any further discussion?
All right. Okay. So I'll make a motion to close discussion.
Okay.
Sorry.
Ryan?
Yes.
Pamplico?
Yes.
Hurry.
Yes.
Turner.
Yes.
Penning.
Yes. Okay. So at this point, then, do we do a motion?
That would this right now. It could be a motion to either renew or sustain, essentially, and ratify the prior determination by this board, or renew and open it up, and then you would do a second motion to subsequently approve it. It's just a procedural matter. But that is obviously that's the board's discretion. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask.
Question of the motion to sustain would ratify what we've already done.
That's correct. Mike, you agree? Ben, just procedurally. Yeah, that's if you ratify it, you sustain what you've already done and close it out. This is just a recommending body. That recommendation would be so ratified and sent to the village board. The Village of Antioch is a non-home rule unit. This is only a recommending body. We do not pass our own variances or special use permits, unlike the City of Chicago or some other municipality.
I'll make a motion to sustain.
I'll second.
You were going to say something, Beth?
I was going to say that absent a motion to sustain, I think you could make a motion to approve without the renewal process, but...
Yeah. Obviously, there's a motion on the floor, but no, I appreciate it.
Okay. Roll call.
Ryan?
Yes.
Campbell?
Yes.
Hardy?
Yes.
Turner?
No.
No. Three votes yes, two votes no. Motion carries.
Goes to the village. Just like last time, it goes to the village board. and village board has ordained authority with regards to this.
Do you know when and by the way, was that just for the record, was that a sustained decision on all three site plan?
We could areas? Do all votes. We could do all the votes.
I think we should. I think
I'm fine with that. We'll do all votes. We could do all votes. So let's go through all the recommendations and go through each one of the votes rather than just one omnibus vote for everything.
All right, Jimmy, I don't know.
You're fine.
So the first should be a motion to sustain the proposed variance provided for relief on the village's solar ordinance.
Correct, the first motion. So Mike laid it out in his.
Got it.
Correct. So why don't we just go through it?
What I just did.
So the PZB would recommend with regards to the variance providing relief from the village's solar ordinance. If we ratify or sustain it, we would stick with the recommendation to deny on the variance with regards to the setbacks, the variant, that's the variance that they need to go for. So if we're going to go through all these at one at a time, which is a reasonable request, then that would be our first, that would be my recommendation is how we go through. You have findings of fact right before you. It's on page 8. We'll just track it 1, 2, 3.
Motion to.
You want to say, you could say ratify or sustain?
Sustain. The proposed variance providing relief for the village's solar ordinance.
Second.
Brian?
Yes.
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 No.
No.
Right, now we have the second one. That after hearing additional testimony submitted by the applicant, recommends the denial of the proposed special use for the solar farm. So again, there was a recommendation for denial before. If we are going forward and denying this or recommending a denial to the village board, then we would ratify or sustain that prior fine.
Motion to sustain the proposed special use for the proposed solar farm.
Second.
Brian?
Yes.
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 No.
No.
And then there's a general recommendation for the denial of the proposed solar farm for the property commonly known as 650 East North Avenue. Again, if we are going forward to recommend to the village board that this matter is recommended for denial, we would ratify or sustain it as we have for the last two.
Motion to sustain the proposed solar farm for the property commonly known as 650 East North Avenue.
I'll second.
Yes.
Yes.
Hardy? Yes.
Turner? No.
No.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
When does this go to the board? We know.
It will probably, I mean, before the end of the month. So I can give you a date. I don't know what the date of the last meeting of the month is. Our next meeting's a week from today, and I just don't know if this will be prepared by that.
Gotcha.
Thank you. Thank you all for your time.
Okay. Mr. Garrigan.
Yes, thank you. I just want to let the Planning Commission know that the CarMax case was actually on the agenda. The applicant has withdrawn their application. So just for the record, the application has been withdrawn. So obviously we're not pursuing that this evening. Mm-hmm. The next matter that's before the board is consistent with our policy every year. You have before you the village's zoning map. In accordance with state statute, the village of Antioch must approve a new zoning map every year. Typically, historically, we've also done that in March. So you have before you in your packet an updated zoning map for 2024. I'm looking for a motion to approve that map.
Do we have a motion?
I just want to see the map first.
What?
There it is.
Can we ask?
What are the modifications?
Can we have those,
yeah, there's been no modifications.
Oh, there's no changes.
Pretty much the same map that you have next year.
Previously.
Yeah. There were some annexations and rezonings.
Right.
Obviously, this year, in 2024, which will be reflected in the 2025 map.
Motion to approve as presented.
Second.
Ryan? Yes.
Yes.
Cardi? Yes.
Turner? Yes.
Yes. And with that, do I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Meeting adjourned.